my lip. Read my lips. Read my lips. Good evening. Good evening. We will proceed with our program. On this festive occasion in the 30th year of our conference, I must begin by extending my respectful congratulations to my colleague from the Department of Psychology, Mark Kruger. He was the chair and the originator of this conference on the brain. When his wife, Sarah heard that the Lord's hand had been laid on him, she said, "Oh, no. Mark, what about your sabbatical?" His work over a period of 1 year and a half, including his sabbatical, without extra remuneration, is the measure of his devotion not only to his discipline, but especially to the students in this college. Mark is an undergraduate of Carthage College in Wisconsin, holds the doctorate from Dartmouth in the field of social psychology. He's been on our faculty for 13 years. We cherish him as a colleague and a friend. Dr. Mark Kruger.
Thank you very much. I have a mic. Thank you very much. I'd like to take this opportunity to acknowledge all of the other people who have made this possible. All of the people, and really everyone at the college is, I think, touched in one way or another by the obligations to make this the best possible event that we can. Everyone has a role to play. I was advised that I spent the entire evening naming everybody that needed to be named, and that this would go on much too long. I do want to have the individuals who are on our committee and hosted members of the conference, if I could have you stand and be acknowledged, I'd appreciate that. So that would be Tim Robinson in psychology, Larry Owen in English, Evelyn O'Keefe, Mark Lammers, Paul Gathercall, Carl Knight, John Hilton, Thank you.
constantly telling me about this wonderful doctor she would see once a week or so, who would come in and she would ask him. She did not have a very much of a formal education, but she was interested in anything. And she would ask this doctor what he thought of the patients, what he thought of certain illnesses. And she'd tell, oh, he's fascinating. And as I say, she tried to tell me this because I was a teenager. And I thought at that point there was absolutely nothing interesting that my mother could tell me. So, unfortunately, several years later when I was in college, I was sitting in our living room reading Awakenings, the hard copy with the photo on the back. And my mother walked by and go, well, isn't that that doc? That's that doctor. Has he written a book? And at that point, I think I learned what the Dr. Kandel mentioned today. Listen to your mother. Which I assumed that Dr. Sachs did. Both his parents were neurologists. His three brothers were also doctors, although I'm not sure what specialties they ended up in. He attended university as a fellow of the Queen's College, Oxford, has lived in the United States since 1960, started out in San Francisco, and then went for what was meant to be a 12-month fellowship in New York City, and has been there ever since 1964, I believe. And he is now associated with, he has long been associated with the Albert Einstein College of Medicine, with Beth Abraham Hospital, and more recently with New York University as an adjunct professor there as well. I did ask him earlier how he would like to be introduced, and he referred to Dr. Churchland's Star Trek slide of yesterday and said, well, you could just describe me as Dr. McCoy, a good old country doctor. I said, I don't think that will do, but if that's what you want, I will now present to you, on the topic of tonight's Conversations at Nobel, Neurology and the Soul, Dr. Oliver Sacks.
Rushed to the library at 6:05, find it. And so I've very much been enjoying my 2 days here and imbibing a sort of sanity and gentleness and sweetness, which is utterly different from New York City. various people have stopped me on the campus and asked if I were Robin Williams. And when I've said no, they say they think I'm imitating Robin Williams. But needless to say, it was the other way around. It's been a special delight being among my distinguished fellow invitees and having such an intellectual feast as I haven't known for a long while, and as all of you, of course, have been enjoying in these last 2 days. I think every talk was more astonishing than the others. And in their different ways, I think they have covered everything from Eric Kandel's molecules David Hubel's systems in the visual cortex, to Damasio's systems, to Richard Churchland's concepts of consciousness. Certainly, one has got a very powerful sense of biology and psychology coming closer, and I think an extraordinary feeling of the complexity and ingenuity and the fabulous quality of the brain. I think for me this especially came out when David Hubel was talking about the visual cortex and its crystalline quality and the sense of this miraculous order which has come about, which no one designed, but which has come about. I think one has got a tremendous sense of the ability of the brain to construct selves and worlds and to embody the thoughts, feelings, aspirations and sensibilities which constitute us as individuals. And I suppose really if I have any theme tonight, it is the, and it's really the theme of the whole conference, and it is the embodiment of individuality, of perception of self, of the soul. Freeman Dyson sometimes likes to say, nature's imagination is richer than ours. And I think one got this feeling very strongly today. Sometimes one fears, or sometimes the fear is expressed, that science will explain everything and everything will be reduced to a sort of dull knowledge. But it's not being reduced. Science heightens. I think that the vision becomes infinitely more wonderful when one thinks of the intricate analysis which starts in the primary visual cortex, goes on with the Damasian systems, and the fact that the visual world is not given to us, but is constructed by us, and it is finally, as it were, the conversation between 100 or 1,000 different parts of the brain. I don't quite know why I chose this title. I used it once before in 1984, and then someone came up afterwards and they said, you haven't actually used the word soul at any point, so I better use it right now. I've just been reading a wonderful essay called The Soul of William James, and I think I'm going to quote a little bit from this. The term soul occurs incessantly in James's conversation and correspondence, yet in his psychology he insisted that it was a useless term. He defined the science of the soul, psychology, as the science of mental processes, and said that in psychology he had no use for the soul. Yet, he wrote, someday, souls may get their innings again. They form a category of thought too natural to the human mind to expire without prolonged resistance. But if the belief in the soul ever does come to life, it will only be when someone has found in the term a pragmatic significance that has hitherto eluded observation. Now, if the term can persist or survive, it will not be as any notion of disembodied spirit, but as the notion of embodied spirit. And I think this is what we're all talking about one way or another. Now, I don't have any lantern slides, and I in fact don't have any text, and I'm ad-libbing, and I may become aphasic at any moment. And not having any lantern slides, I got just a few quotes to sort of get me going. There was a very close friend of William James, was F.W.H. Miles, who was a great classical scholar and mathematician and polymath, and also slightly bizarrely, like many savants at the end of the last century, found a member of the Society for Psychical Research. And he wrote a very strange book. I would like to give you just a short title, which is Human Personality. In fact, its whole title is Human Personality, Protestant, which in a way is about biology and psyche. He says, I regard each man as at once profoundly unitary and almost infinitely composite, as inheriting from earthly ancestors a multiplex and colonial organism, polyzoic, perhaps polypsychic in an extreme degree, but also as ruling and unifying that organism by a soul or spirit absolutely beyond our present analysis. Now, I like this notion very much, and the polyzoic and the polypsychic becomes the thousand systems which Damasio and Hubel have been talking, all of which are biologically ancient or which have emerged during the course of phylogeny. The question is whether there is any coordination and what sort of coordination there is. David was saying earlier that with the advance of science, many of the poetic and mythical terms, like the heavens and the sky, have to be abandoned. And he wondered whether the mind, as an entity, as a thing, has to be abandoned. I think it does, as a thing. But we shouldn't be reifying, shouldn't be talking about things. We need to be talking about processes. And this is very, very clear in William James, where he talks about the stream of consciousness and its density, richness, kaleidoscopic quality, stability, and the fact that it is always impregnated with personal reference. There's not just a stream of consciousness, there's your stream, and yours, and yours, and yours. Yesterday at the firing line, or whatever it's called, I did in fact drop the glass of wine. You know, and drinking is such a private, delicate thing. And here you have to do this obscene thing in front of 9,900 people. It was even difficult in front of 30 people. Although everyone has been talking about the union of biology and psychology, it seems to me that there hasn't been very much use of a word like self or identity. People have been talking about systems, but not about self or identity. And I want to see if we can justify talking about this. Hume, who is my favorite philosopher and the most passionate and candid of philosophers, denies identity, denies personal identity. He denies that philosophy, at least, can ever reach to personal identity. He describes his own position when this is the case, when he feels himself on a barren rock, surrounded by a dangerous sea. The denial of identity fills him with what he calls a philosophical melancholy, and he can only deal with this by having dinner with his friends, or playing backgammon, or, in other words, recovering some sense of personal identity. Now, as a physician, I forgot, I should have been watching the time. I bring these obsessive watches, 2, 3, 4 of them, you know, to try and time myself, and then my cunning unconscious sort of makes sure I don't look at them. As a physician and as a neurologist, I think one is constantly faced with questions of identity and with the way in which people construct lives. And sometimes, even in the most unlikely contexts, sometimes it's also pretty boring. You make a diagnosis and give a pill, and that's all there is to it. The next Sunday, he didn't phone me up. So I phoned him up the following day and said, well, what happened? And he said in a dull voice, he'd taken the pill, he didn't have a migraine. He said, but he was bored. He didn't know what to do. No one came to visit him. He didn't receive any sympathy. He didn't have the wonderful feeling of reanimation, which one can sometimes have after one has almost been annihilated by a migraine. And he said, something's going to happen. The following Sunday, I did get a phone call, an emergency phone call from his sister, saying that he was in the throes of a severe asthma attack, a status asthmaticus. Paramedics were there, and he was being given oxygen, and and she hoped that my treatment had not resulted in her brother's death. Later, when he came out of this, I spoke to him, and I said, well, why don't I give you something for your asthma? And he said, if you do, I'll get something else. He said, do you think I need to be ill on Sundays? Now, this was a very strange question, one which about the economy of an entire life, and one which really said to me, in effect, it's not sufficient just to diagnose the migraine and fix it. You have to assert its place in the whole texture of a life and of a personality. And so that was a very, very important primary lesson for me. I think I should tell you some clinical stories. I've listed 42 of them, but I should probably stick to two or three, which really have to do with identity and disease and the danger of intervening medically before one has considered the total consequences of what might happen. I guess I first ran into this with the awakenings patients. If one just thought in terms of an absent neurotransmitter, a loss of dopamine, bringing these patients to a halt, slowing them down, and then getting them going and awakening the dopamine, medically, this seemed a very simple business. However, what happened when one awakened patients who had been suspended for 30 years was very complex and often very tragic. There was one patient, the Mozart of awakenings, kept talking about 1926, and kept talking about Gershwin as if he was still alive. And I first thought she was disoriented. I asked her some questions, and she said, look, I know it's 1969, but I feel it's 1926. She said, I know I'm 64, but I feel I'm 21. And she indicated that she had been out of it, in a sense, for 43 years, and that there was a 21-year-old woman in a 64-year-old body. She went on to say that everything which had meaning for her and feeling had vanished from the world. She'd been abandoned by her family. Everything and everyone which interested her had gone. She says she didn't like our world. She didn't ask to be placed in it. She felt an anachronism. And after 10 days, she suddenly reverted to the strange trance-like state she'd been in for 43 years, and neither held open or anything else. This was an extreme example, but with all of these patients, I wondered whether I had done them. But it's, I should say that ultimately, most of the patients said they were glad they had had the L-DOPA. They only wish they could have had it 10 or 20 or 30 years before so much of their moves and their nervous systems had been destroyed. Let me tell you another story. This I've written about this man. I called him Virgil in the story helpful as well. He said, "Schirl sees." And I said, well, what does he see? And the answer was, he sees nothing, or rather, he has no idea what he's seeing. And so there was a simple notion that either the operation would work or it wouldn't work. If it didn't work, Schirl would stay blind. If it worked, he would emerge as a sighted man and step forward into the visual world. Of course, what happened was neither of these. He was given his eyes, but his brain had no idea how to use the visual information. As is the case, basically, in someone who has been congenitally blind, close to congenitally blind. Schirl described his first experience when the bandages were taken off. There was movement, and there was color, and there was a blur. It was not intelligible. He didn't know what he was seeing, and indeed if this was seeing. And then out of this blur, there came a voice, the voice of his surgeon. And since he knew that voices come from faces, he realized that this blur, this chaos of light and movement, was a face. There was no carryover from the tactile concept of a face to the visual concept. And this severe confusion didn't merely apply to faces, it applied to everything. He couldn't recognize the simplest shapes at first. He struggled very bravely. Now, this is not an imaginable situation, because the rest of us have been making a visual world in a visual sense, using the mechanisms which David Hubel and others have described since birth. We have never been at a total loss visually. The man who mistook his wife for a hat was at a loss visually because his recognition systems had been blown by disease. Schirl was at a loss because his recognition systems had never developed. His equable life as a blind man was severely disturbed. He could no longer cross the road safely. He saw unintelligible shapes suddenly getting larger, looming on him. He found himself in a state of terror for much of the time. Increasingly, he closed his eyes, or he failed to switch on the light. And here again, one wondered whether the gift of sight was in fact a gift for someone who had been so totally adapted to the world of touch. This particular matter was considered by John Locke, by Molyneux, by philosophers in the 17th century. And here again, one wondered very much whether it was the right thing to have operated on this man. Let me tell you another story. Incidentally, some of these stories, I hope I'm not advertising, are going to appear in a future book in a couple of months, which has the subtitle of Seven Paradoxical Tales. They're paradoxical because, in a way, they're all partly about the mischief of medical intervention, way in which one creates a world and an identity which matches the way one is. I had another patient whom Tony DiMaggio knew a bit, an artist who, following a head injury in his 60s, suddenly lost all color perception, found himself in a black and white world. He first felt this as a complete disaster. Thought it was the end of him as an artist, but also as a person. He couldn't bear the sight of his food. He couldn't bear the sight of his wife. She looked gray. He couldn't bear the sight of himself. Nor could memory or imagination help him. They were as gray or as denuded of color as perception. The brain couldn't construct color. And now, at first, there was a sort of sensibility. His disability became a sensibility. Or let me put it another way. His world, his visual world, was reconstructed as rich, complete, coherent, dense, beautiful, but without color. And then in that much later, we wondered whether he would like color back, if it were possible to give him color back. And he said, indeed, he yearned for this for the first 6 months, but then he started to forget color, to forget what color was about. He couldn't imagine it anymore. And now he felt that, in fact, he had a rather privileged and refined vision and sensibility, and that the rest of us were distracted by irrelevant sensations of one sort and another. He thought that if he had been given color back, he would now have difficulty. It would seem redundant in a world which was now complete without it. So here again, there's potential analogies to the case of Shirl. Now, that leaves me with the 39 other cases to speak about. Which I can't. One of the people I've written about in my new book is a surgeon with Tourette's syndrome. I first saw this man with his violent convulsive movements, his barks and yelps at a conference, and I wondered how he survived. I asked him what he did. I thought he was going to tell me he was on Social Security or something. He said he was a surgeon. And I said, you're joking. And he invited me to come and visit him and spend a week with him in Canada. He practiced as a general surgeon in a small town there. Well, I did this, and here again, in fact, there was no Touretting when he was operating. And this was very remarkable to see. I know another person, a young man with severe Tourette syndrome in Canada, who was an artist, and a very fine artist. And this Touretic artist refuses medication. He feels that anything which helps his Tourette's, or I'm sorry, anything which treats his Tourette's, or alters his Tourette's, alters him. If one has had something like Tourette's, which has a sort of strange energy, vitality, impulsiveness of its own, if one has had Tourette since the age of 3, it has wound itself, it has interwoven itself with one's character and feelings and personality in an almost inseparable way. The Touretic surgeon himself said this. He said, I can't quite call it a disease. It's part of me. It's part of the way I am. And so one can't just look at Tourette's as a disease. You have to see it partly as a mode of being. And so this again is a complex matter. One can define similar things, I think, sometimes with autistic people. And I wrote recently about a gifted autistic woman who is actually a great expert. She is the world's expert on cattle psychology and cattle behavior, although she is very perplexed human behavior, although she says she is studying the species closely, and she says she often feels like an anthropologist on Mars. But she sometimes lectures, and she's a very good lecturer, and in one recent lecture she said, if I could snap my fingers and be non-autistic, I wouldn't, because being autistic is part of the way I am. Now, she does not romanticize autism any more than the surgeon romanticizes Tourette's. The suffering and the disability and some of the isolation and stigmatization is fully acknowledged. But at the same time, this has become part of the way one is. For this reason, it's never sufficient in writing a case history just to speak of a disease or the course of a disease. A pathography isn't sufficient. I think one needs a full biography which gives the entire pattern of a life. there's a nice story. I mentioned William James. I ought to mention Henry James. When Henry James was dying in a terminal pneumonia delirium, 1914, he raved. But the style of his ravings, it was said, was pure Henry James. And not only pure James, but late James. Style, character, emotion is the deepest part of one's being. It's the most resilient, it's the most robust. And one finds, say, with Alzheimer's disease, that even when people can no longer speak or think conceptually, they can be deeply affected, say, by art, by music. This will call to them, it will recall their identity in the most remarkable way. Sometimes this is just transient, but the self and world which originally went with the music can be brought back. In fact, I just returned from South Africa from a series of conferences on music therapy, and but especially the power of music in deeply identity, deeply disorganized people, to recall identity, however briefly, is quite extraordinary. Now, last night, you had here art and music in between the lectures, and one wonders, how do art and music work? Now, I said I had an impulse at 10 to 6 to run to the library to look up something in Schopenhauer, and if I can find it. Schopenhauer, as you know, wrote a huge book called The World as Will and Representation. And music for him consisted of pure will. And if I can read some of this, he says, music is quite independent of the phenomenal world, positively ignores it, to a certain extent it could still exist even if there were no world at all. Cannot be said the other arts. For this reason, and he speaks of music as a copy of the will itself, he says, for this reason, its effect is very much more powerful and penetrating than that of the other arts, for these others speak only of the shadow, but music of the essence. Whenever I see a new neurology book, first thing I do is to look up music, the index. And if music isn't well considered, I feel the neurology book hasn't got to the heart of the matter. I think I will end by saying that, I better end by saying that only when we have concepts and information which, say, begin to allow us to understand how art works, how music works, what creativity is about, where we have begun to approach any real neurology of the soul. And I think it's happening now. I think this has been incredibly exciting 40 years or so. And my guess is that in 20 years or so, we'll have a very good idea of this. If we have a good idea, it won't deprive us of music and art and the spirit. I think it will heighten it and dignify it as never before. Thank you very much.
asked you to meet the speakers at our conference this year. First, to say a thank you to you, Dr. Sachs, for seven lovely pieces I encountered. Tapestries from the enchanted loom behind those eyes. I was watching them. How do you do that? And music, too. That was the first evening we met together. Conversation turned to music, what we listen to, what the students listen to, and I walked out with Dr. Hubel and just threw out for grabs a Bela Bartok, and Dr. Hubel said, "Oh, I like Bela Bartok," and I got to thinking about that later, where Bartok many of you in this room are from around four or five states, some of you from farther away than that. Many of you are students in high schools, colleges, universities. This is our 30th year. I was thinking about that. Our real text for this conference throughout these years was to bring together research scientists who were finest in this country and throughout the world, together with some of you, because we wanted to challenge you to consider research sciences in your own life. So again, these last 2 days, it seems to me that I heard from the six very famous neuroscientists that gathered here a number of challenges to you to consider the challenge that might lie for you in research sciences, particularly in the neurosciences. So I've asked each one in a way of saying hello to them tonight at this dinner, to say something of what challenge might lie ahead for you in the neurosciences, or something of what lies ahead in the discipline, as they see it. First, I call upon Dr. David Hubel, our Nobel laureate in medicine 1981 of the Harvard Medical School. Dr. Hubel.
This will be strictly ad lib because the advance notice was 0 seconds. So, but what can I say? I guess I could recapitulate, in fact, repeat all of the talks that you've heard, because I think that's exactly what we've been trying to do. I don't know what the future holds. I don't know how long it's going to take. 10 or 30 or 50 years to get where we want to go. Looking back at the last 30 years, when Torsten Wiesel and I started our work, we had come up with orientation selectivity within about 6 months of starting to work together. We thought that was a good start. We told Vernon Mountcastle, who's perhaps the leading neurophysiologist had sort of hoped to be by then onto the auditory system. So looking, that being so, you can imagine how slightly stunned I am by the assignment of asking what the future holds. Just don't know. And as I said, I think before already, I don't want to quote myself, but as Steve Hoover said, nothing is harder to predict than the future. Nobody would have predicted then, in 1950, it was 58 or 59, that within a few years we'd have a basic, broad outline kind of understanding of life. And yet we do. Not that there are thousands of wonderful details left to be discovered. But I don't think that would have been predictable at all. I don't think the same thing is going to be true of the nervous system, simply because the brain is made up of many parts and each one is going to have to be understood. If we ever want to get on top of it, we'll have general principles, I'm sure, more than we do today. But we won't understand the entire brain for some time any more than we'll have described the 3D shape of all the important proteins. It's just not that kind of deal. Well, I think, I hope I've done justice to the assignment. Thank you. Let me just say what a pleasure this last couple of days has been. Again, not only because of the fun of talking to a number of new friends, the other speakers, but meeting so many people, so many wonderful people, especially getting to talk to a large number of students. It's been a real pleasure. Thanks.
I owe you an apology. I warned the others about a half hour ago, and I thought I'd come around to you. Thank you, sir. Dr. Antonio Damasio, the Department of Neurology, College of Medicine, University of Iowa.
So this is also short notice, but apparently a little longer than for David. It's about half an hour, so I had time to make some notes. And what I thought of making is a list of the things that I thought were important in the past 3 days for me and for Hannah. And here goes the list. Number one, our hosts. I think our hosts are absolutely tremendous. And I'm not going to name names because I know that I will leave out somebody very important, so I won't say it. Organizers of the conference too, at least I know Mark Kruger, that should be newspapers for 3 days. And so you look around Gustavus and you imagine that the social fabric of the Western culture is still intact, and that, and you have the illusion that it is a very beautiful world, and of course it isn't. Then the last points, they're the ones that he really wanted me to talk about, have to do with the future, and really it's wonderful. There are a couple of things that are probably important. One, we all talked about the excitement of neuroscience. We know that it is a tremendous time, and we all saw the reasons why it is exciting. There's one more that I did not mention. I was talking about the excitement from the point of view of science itself. There's also the point of view of the application. Science is at its best when it's satisfying our curiosity, and also when it has the chance of being applied in something very useful. Change us. And I think that probably the greatest challenge that we're facing, and it's not as neuroscientists or as scientists in general, but as citizens, as beings in the world, is really having a world that will survive. And I think that there's a very good chance that what we're doing in neurobiology at the moment, especially when you see neurobiology conceived across all levels, as came through in many of the talks, it's absolutely unlikely that the knowledge from that biology will not influence the kind of world in which we live in, and will not help us if we really want to solve some of the problems. I'm not saying that neurobiology will solve the problems of the world, but it can certainly help. And I think that probably the greatest challenge, especially for the students, is to try to use what is coming from neurobiology and science in general to make this a better world. Is quite a lot of room for that. And then to be hopeful for that world, and one good thing is not to watch TV news and not to read papers, and the other is to think that if we really had to change the world, just have to count on biological evolution, I think there would be very good reasons to be pessimistic because it was so slow. But fortunately, we have some ways in which we can influence evolution at a very rapid level, and that has to do with culture and society. And if we can contribute to that culture, we can actually perhaps solve some of the problems which, when we do look at TV news and we look at newspapers, really sound and look so insurmountable. Okay, thank you very much.
I wish also to recognize Dr. Hannah Damasio, the director of the University Bioism Laboratory for Neuroimaging and Human Neuroanatomy. We know her as well. Delighted to be here. Thank you. Sitting next to this charming woman on Monday evening at dinner, I decided to reclaim my Portuguese ancestry. Dr. Patricia Churchley of the University of San Diego, California.
Thank you from the chapel. For an after dinner speaker. I would actually like to start with a quote also from a James. This is Jesse James. Well, you got to just stand up and do it. I don't really know what to say. But one of the things, of course, that's so wonderful about science that makes it a great privilege is that you can follow your passion about something. And to other people, sometimes it seems like a very odd sort of passion, because it doesn't necessarily have to do with making money, and it doesn't necessarily have to do with keeping good hours or having a comfortable office. It's often very uncomfortable. And yet there is something really very wonderful about being able to follow your passion. And it does remind me, actually, of a story about nature and taking it all in, and then heard this funny little squeaking sound. Hey, pick me up, pick me up. She saw a frog, rather nice big frog, and she looked a little closer, and the little boy said, hey, pick me up, pick me up. I'm really bewitched and enchanted. I'm really a prince, a very handsome prince. Pick me up, pick me up. And so she picked him up, looked at him. He said, now kiss me, kiss me. I'm really a handsome prince. I'm enchanted. Kiss me, I'm a handsome prince, and I'll make you happy forever and ever. She sort of looked. Some prince. I'll make your life happy. I'll love you forever. Being a scientist, she sort of stops and said, look, given my age and my interests, I'd really rather have a talking frog. Find hard to understand. But it is, I think, one of the really wonderful privileges of being in science that you are able to follow your passion and follow your curiosity where it leads you. And we are privileged indeed to live in a culture that allows us the opportunity to do that, because it is a very, very special thing to be able to not just do the heavy work and the heavy lifting of survival, but to be able to do this really very special and this very wonderful thing of being engaged in science. And it's important, I think, to reflect a little bit on how fortunate we are, because the institution of science is, of course, vulnerable. It's vulnerable to political pressures of a variety of kinds. It's vulnerable to economic pressures. It's vulnerable to the ravages of plagues and war and so forth. And because it is such an important enterprise, and because it is something that we pass down and down and down through the generations, it is also something that I think we really need to protect. We need to protect its openness, its ability to accept criticism. We need to protect it from those who would change it to channel it into something very narrow and something that is guided by ideology. We need to protect it from those who say, why follow a passion to understand something like the nature of the atom? Why don't you do something practical? Because, of course, very often it's the most astonishingly powerful practical devices that come out of a pure passion for a pure idea of some kind or other. So it's a great thing to be able to do, and I think many of the students here already have the excitement and the sense of fun and thrill that comes about as a result of being in science.
Dr. Eric Richard Kandel, Center for Neurobiology and Behavior, Columbia University, New York City. Gosh.
Thank you, Richard. These are hot acts to follow, I must say. I was really struck in following the talks of the last several days about of the academic enterprise in the United States. I'm an emigre, and I notice practically, in fact, every single speaker symposium is an emigre. And that, I think, really describes not only the American academic scene, but it describes America. Because
out very early on in coming here that what I really liked most about America was its academic enterprise, its university life. When I first came to Hamburg, it was to me like discovering heaven as an undergraduate. And it's never left me. The wonder, the joy of being in a university. And so over the years, I've become a student of university life. I like to see what makes universities tick and why one university can succeed in one area while it may fail in another, or why universities succeed in others fail. And of course, it comes down to many, many things. It comes down to resources and so on. But even more, it comes down to vision. Now think of it. Here is a small liberal arts college in the Midwest, in the whole country, started by Scandinavian immigrants, rather prominent, and some leader had the idea 30 years ago to start Stockholm's proposal. It is the most extraordinary idea I've ever seen in America, to bring to the small college scholars of all ranks, and to expose them to young people is fantastic for the scholars. I would hope, pleasant for the young people. It's really an extraordinary, energetic enterprise, which has dramatically influenced the quality of your life. And it shows what really great academic leadership is about. I think this is something all of us will remember for the rest of our lives. This is the kind of thing that really changes the university in a profound way. And I think it's really succeeded in doing it. You seem to be doing it better and better. This is a marvelous experience. The second thing I wanted to say is that one of the things that struck me about being here is that it gives you a sense also of the nature of university life in the United States. Somebody asked me, why would somebody want to go to a small college? And after all, there's one bear out there, one large research university. What's the big deal? Now, I have two children who want to go to a small college. And I really know, these are very different kinds of experiences. And the wonderful thing about having this diversity of college life that we have in the United States is that the kids can choose. There are kids who feel much more comfortable in an environment in which they get to know the faculty. Pat Churchill, for example, said, may I can't exactly say, but in many large universities, you cannot have access to the really great professors. They're too busy. They have too many courses. They're doing other things. They have a career. So they interact with the teaching assistant teachers. Well, here, you really get to know the people who actually run the course. Having spoken about the wonderful aspect of university life in both large colleges and small, let me also say something about science itself. This is sort of, I think, continuing a past thing. It's a fantastic life. It really is. I mean, David and I have been so busy. Always come away having lots of laughs, having one or two meals together, try if possible to have a glass of wine together. It's really, when you think of it, you know, we get paid our way to come, we get paid our way to fly back, we have a chance to interact with Pat Churchill. This is a hell of a living, David. It's really, it is absolutely remarkable. My wife keeps on telling me that I should collect frequent flyer miles on the trips that I go on. I was laughing at her. I mean, we get so many opportunities to travel, many of which we have to turn down because we have to make a living at home. That, it, you know, where would I go that I don't get invited to? So it really is, if you have the opportunity to have an academic career, grab it. It's just a wonderful way to live. I want to say in all seriousness a few things about the nature of neurobiology as I see it. I'm repeating things that other people said, forgive me. It's just that with the half hour Richard gave me as a notice, I scribbled down a few thoughts. None of these are original. But most of what I told you the other day, this morning probably wasn't original. I think I pointed out to you before that most of us feel really that biology is a spectacular thing. David also has pointed out, and I really agree with him on that, that many of the fascinating problems in biology are reaching resolution, not solution. Problems in science never solved. Carl said, problems never get solved. Science just get confused. And I think that's what's going to happen. I think the problem of development is not going to be solved, but we understand in outline the body plan that we did 3 years ago, and we see how conserved it is from fruit fly to mice to human beings. So we're getting insight into development that we didn't have before. And my guess is after 20 years, maybe 10 years, people will say, so I think there's going to be a major shift within biology in which neurobiology, which now I think occupies 10 or 15% of biology, if you were just observe it, will become really one of the central problems. And the issues of the mind, the kinds of issues that Oliver addressed, are the issues that people are concerned with. And I think that's going to be absolutely marvelous. And I think, again, Demasius has emphasized this. One of the reasons I think many of us really came from other disciplines, really like neurobiology so much, is it's a natural bridge to the humanities. Neurobiology, like the humanities, is really concerned with the nature of men and women, how they tick. These are really wonderful problems, and as Tony pointed out, socially relevant problems. To think that much of biology is going to devote itself to these problems over the next 20, 30 years, I find really quite inspiring. Thank you very much.
Dr. Apostolos Georgopoulos, Brain Sciences Center, University of Minnesota.
Well, here's another immigrant. Needless to say, what a great pleasure it was to be in this conference, not only to see old friends, new friends, but really to be among brightest students and so refreshingly looking to the future, to really dealing with issues that although we try to summarize, I don't think we can even imagine that are coming up. I think Dr. Sachs summarized, I think, the crucial issues, that most meaningful ones that we'll be facing neuroscience very succinctly. Those that we shouldn't somehow lose in our horizon. All science is quite dry. There's no doubt about that. The day-to-day work is full of chores, and science on a day-to-day basis, beyond the traveling and the enjoyment of such conferences, is a very sharp, abstract, analytic procedure. I think one almost needs to consciously look at problems and define them, not because the fashion is what it is, but because they are the most meaningful problems, I think, of human existence. And these I would again repeat Dr. Sachs is identifying as the self, consciousness, and these as processes rather than as reified abstract things. Now, I wish I were a student. I'm not necessarily terribly old. I'm not terribly young either. I do envy students that are now in high school, in this college, eyes open, looking at the future, and really looking at making some, I would say, important contributions, but really having a bright, fresh look to all of these matters. I think David Hubel and Eric Andel and the rest of the speakers, myself included to some extent, have been very optimistic about the future or the next 20 years or so. Probably in the long run, I'm less optimistic. All of this life being neuroscience, I felt like swimming in honey. Just think. things are quite difficult to deal with and grasp and make sense of all of these theories of cells interacting and so on and so forth. But I think that's where the new challenge is, and where new discoveries can be made, not just finishing up a job that we have started, but really getting some fresh outlooks on how the brain works. If I knew the answer to that, I wouldn't have been here perhaps. I would have been, somehow enjoying other things. But it is a very great privilege for these younger age students to really look at the brain as a fresh outlook, integrating what we all know, but I think we do need, some fresh approaches. And we can very well continue to do what we're doing, but I think we're quite well shaped, all of us. Carved in, we're made up of things, and we're still thinking along the ways we have been thinking. I think it's up to the very young generation, college age and high school, to really break open new horizons in neuroscience. I just want to close somehow. It seems that Dr. Björklund is flying to Sweden right now, repeating the story that David Huber just mentioned, which we both became aware a couple of, maybe two or three weeks ago, that I was visiting Harvard. And I was very fortunate to be trained by Vernon Mountcastle myself, a neurophysiologist. I finished my medical school in Athens, did a PhD in biochemistry, I did about 6 years of liquid research, and I decided that the only reasonable thing to do was to study the brain. That was the most meaningful thing, the most exciting, challenging. So I went to neurophysiology without ever having seen an oscilloscope in my life. I didn't know how electrical activity was in cells and all of that. Now, why Vernon Mountcastle accepted me as a postdoctoral fellow, it still beats me. He probably liked Greeks or something. Well, in any case, that turned out to be a very nice time, nice relationship, got trained. And then when I went back to Greece and things didn't work out for research, I came back to Johns Hopkins. I was talking to Vernon what somehow I explained to him. I want to study the human mind, if you want, or the brain mechanisms underlying all of this stuff we're talking. Well, he said, you have to start from a simple system. Understand that, take care of it in 5 years, and then you move to more complicated things. Well, and as I was interested in the motor system, he said, why don't you start from the motor cortex? That's straightforward, get the base to compare then more complicated areas. Well, I'm still doing it, and that is 20 years after that, and it's been one of the greatest pleasures to be in that system. Every day is a new, not new discovery, new insight of how things could be. Possibilities, how even the most simplest or theoretically simplest small circuits could work together. And I wish all the young people a very creative career in neuroscience. Those of you that you are really thrilled by it, you are going to be rewarded both personally and making some new, opening new horizons in the field.
Thank our speakers again. You represented the best traditions of this conference, and you may have outperformed all of the 29 previous conferences. My colleagues and I will determine that tomorrow at the coffee table when we sit down to rank it. In any event, we owe you a great debt for taking almost 3 days out of your schedules. And now it is my pleasure to and our president, Dr. Axel Steuer.
I thought Dick was also going to say yet another immigrant. This one from southern Sweden, as you know. So, David Jubal, there is one other line that might be helpful when people ask you to predict the future, and this is another one-liner. That is that the future is very much like the present, only different. But I do have one prediction to make about the future, and it's actually the form of an announcement, and that is that we know, because he told us so today, that Dr. Philip Anderson, Nobel laureate in physics and speaker at the next October's Nobel Conference, will be the first Robert and Susan Rydell Distinguished Nobel Conference Professor in the spring of 1996. That is word we just received today in the middle of the conference. One autobiographical point, I guess, or observation, and that is that some of us who were trained as philosophers some 30 years ago and were convinced that one of the most exciting set of intellectual puzzles centered around the so-called mind-brain problem, or perhaps even the identity problem, I discovered, I guess, these last couple of days, perhaps sadly, that some of these very exciting puzzles seem to be very far along toward resolution, and that perhaps philosophers of mind, as we used to call ourselves, are well advised to pursue administrative careers. For those of you who have been with us for all or most of these past 2 days, it will be obvious why these annual Nobel conferences are among the high points of the academic career or the academic year at Gustavus Adolphus College. For 30 years now, we've suspended regular classes for 2 days in order to provide our students with a very special and extraordinary learning experience. And as we bring this conference on unlocking the brain to a close, we do so with a certain degree of satisfaction that not only our own students, but also students from around college schools and colleges around the country, and friends from around the country, some 5,000 plus have been significantly enriched by events on this campus these last couple of days. For this, we owe a very special debt of gratitude to our outstanding speakers and panelists. And yes, the topic of the brain is inherently fascinating. And yes, we are not surprised by the outstanding intellects, dare I say minds, and dedication to truth that we've been privileged to encounter. But we also met in these people an uncommon generosity of spirit, an inspiring passion for their subject matters we just heard, and wonderful expressions of humor. Each of us now has a new repertoire of stories to tell. Dr. Kendall, especially, let me just say thank you for your suggestion that the brain scans might soon verify the effectiveness of our curriculum. That is great comfort to a college president wrestling all the time with how to respond to demands from all quarters for accountability and for assessment, that's to say, to demonstrate that we do what we say we do. I look forward, if I'm still in the business 20 years from now, checking these kind of things out. For all of us, this 30th Nobel Conference has been an intellectual event and also an aesthetic event, as it was noted earlier, of the very first order. It was truly kept alive, the tradition, the long tradition of Nobel conferences that are timely, that are of exceptionally high intellectual quality, and are nonetheless accessible. I guess maybe the word would be user-friendly almost, to large, interested, and informed general audience. This tradition was well sustained. Our brains have been wonderfully stimulated. Speaking for the entire Gustavus community, I want to express our deep appreciation to David Bell, Antonio Damasio, Patricia Churchland, Eric Kandel, Apostolos Georgopoulos, and then Anders Bjorklund, I guess, is on his way back to Sweden. So Oliver Sacks, also thank you for seeing to it that we had a most memorable Davis. You've made a real difference here in southern Minnesota, and you have greatly enriched the life of our college in just 2 brief days. I dare say that you've been able to do this because you are all teachers of the highest order. You obviously care deeply about your life's work that you've shared with us, and you obviously care for those of us who are eager to learn more about that wondrous organ in the middle of our heads. We want to thank you for the extraordinary teaching and learning that has taken place at Gustavus these past 48 plus hours. I know from talking to high school students on campus yesterday and today that college and career choices were made right here. And I also know from the excited conversations in public areas all around the campus that there's splendid evidence here of your influence on all the guests disabled these last 2 days. There are many people who worked long and hard, some for more than 2 years, to make this Nobel Conference a reality. I only want to mention here the good efforts and rich imagination of Chaplain Richard Elby, the overall director of these conferences. For those who have not been close to a radio all day, you should know that the good chaplain was honored with WCCO's Good Neighbor Award today for his long leadership role in these conferences. Let me read what hundreds of thousands of Minnesotans heard this morning. Quote, this morning we salute a theologian and scientist, an author and counselor, a teacher and friend to thousands of students, parents and friends of Gustavus Adolphus College, St. Peter, Minnesota. Now in this 33rd year as chaplain, in the second decade as director of the Nobel Conference, our WCCO Good Neighbor has balanced the chapel and science hall simultaneously. I can just picture Richard balancing the chapel and the science hall. Richard Q. Elby of St. Peter, Minnesota has set the seasons to poetry and has engaged young minds in the pursuit of astrophysics and neuroscience. He moves among great minds and always credits his colleagues for inspiration, philanthropists for their generosity, his friends for their encouragement. Today at Gustavus Adolphus College, he plays host to nearly 6,000 students, teachers and friends of the college at the 30th Nobel Conference. Congratulations, Chaplain Elby, and best wishes at the Nobel Conference, WCCO Radio. And I'm going to call on Mark Kruger to make a presentation.
Dick, I thought it was important that we not pass by this 30th event without acknowledging your role in making all of this happen. In the spring of 1981, I came here to interview this institution. I had been married for 3 months, and I had a wife that supported me through all this period of time and through graduate school. It made my participation in events like this possible, but I knew it was going to be difficult to bring her here from New Hampshire. And as I was here for the interview, one of the people that made a big impact on me then was the interview with the chaplain at the college, who was probing me about my background as the son of a Lutheran minister, but also providing me with an insight into the life of this institution, the life and intellectual journey that all of us aspire to participate in. I think for those of us who are here at the institution, we'll all recognize that no one here has taken a broader path, a wider path. I pass Chaplain Elvin on to another friend who will be doing a conference on material science next year. Imagine the work that he has to do. As I think about the 2 years I spent preparing to make this conference work, and I get to rest tomorrow, this man has to figure out now superconductors. I'm sure that Potts has him grinding one very soon. Imagining floating trains. And for all of this effort, for making this college, I think, an extremely special place over a long number of years, I wanted to add my very personal thank you and to let you know that I think many of us see you as a model for intellectual life.
Yes, it is heavy. I should say that despite the fact that he often talks like an unrepentant Hegelian idealist, Richard's brain teamed up beautifully, or wonderfully, with that of Professor Mark Kruger to develop the theme and concept and to give birth to this particular conference. So thank you to you also, Mark, and again to the many, many people who deserve our thanks for this conference. Most surely, as was mentioned earlier, Dean Wallen, the staff in public affairs, and Pat Franchek, serving on visual, and Steve Children, his outstanding, and I gather tonight, perhaps very exhausted, staff and planning service. These people and the student hosts and everyone else here, many others, made this stimulating meeting of the minds possible. Once again, to our distinguished speakers, we've called upon your knowledge, your wisdom, your energy, your goodwill, and even your patience, and you've responded on all counts. For that, we thank you, and we wish you Godspeed. All of our guests from off campus, we wish you a safe journey home and invite you to mark your calendar for next year's 31st Nobel Conference on the New Shape of Matter, Materials Challenge Science, which is scheduled for October 3rd and 4th. And so with that wish and that reminder, we formally bring this 30th Annual Nobel Conference to a close. Dear friends,